Hi there. My name is Andy Cook, and I am excited to welcome you to Panama Baptist Church Online. If you consider yourself to be an anonymous guest, hey, thanks for checking our church out. If you're drawn to what you see and hear, you might consider joining us online at a live chat service. They're held Sunday mornings at 9 a.m., although most people jump on at about 8:45. To see a live chat service, you just go to panamabaptist.org and follow the link. The service is similar to what you find here on YouTube, but has some additional features. Or if you live in the area, you could join us at an in-person gathering. Again, it's similar to what you find here at the YouTube channel, but has even more additional features. I want to pause before we jump into the things and just express my deep gratitude to those of you who have given financially to PBC. Through you, we are taking steps toward our vision as a church, and through you, we are preparing for a much-needed building project, so thank you. Really, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. All right, let's pray before we get into the rest of our service together. Father God, I want to thank you so much for providing for us as a church. I don't take that for granted, and I know the rest who are here in leadership at PBC don't take that for granted either. Thank you for blessing us, Lord, and thank you for enabling us to be a blessing to others through our mission works, through our generosity works, through our ministries. Lord, thank you so much. Father, I want to ask that you would speak to us today. You know the needs of our hearts. God, we need to hear from you. We are here to listen to you. God, some of us need to have an encounter with you. We need you to meet with us in a very special and a very profound way. And for those of us who are in that need, God, I pray that you will meet us here and give us that encounter that we so desperately need. Father, I know that we need to worship you. And so I pray that as we listen to the songs and perhaps participate along, and as we listen to the scriptures and the teaching time today, and as we just kind of think through the various things and participate with that, God, I pray that we will be worshiping you and that you will accept our worship, that you'll find it pleasing. God, that you will be glad that you are spending this time with us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You came from heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe, your suffering for our freedom. The Lamb of God in my place, your blood poured out, my sin erased, it was my death, you died, I am raised to life, hallelujah, the Lamb of God. My name upon your heart, my shame upon your shoulders, the power of sin undone, the cross for my salvation. No greater love. Savior lifted up. There is no greater love.
There's no greater love.
No greater love. There is no greater love. The Savior. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still. Among the saints.
Let's talk about Pastor Joel. Seriously, Pastor Joel is a fantastic pastor. He really, really is. I mean, he cares deeply for us. I've been on the receiving end of his pastoral care. He is a competent leader, a deep thinker about what it is that we need to be doing as a church and how God would lead us. Pastor Joel is biblically consistent in his character. He is a good communicator of the Word of God. We are so blessed to have him as a pastor here at Panama Baptist Church. Really and truly, God has blessed us through him. But that's not what I want to talk about. I want to talk about how did Pastor Joel become such a big Broncos fan? I mean, really, how did this happen? Right? Well, I don't know how it started, but I know how he got to where it is today. In a word, habits, right? Habits. Somewhere along the line, he started watching the games, and as he was watching those games, he became emotionally invested in whether or not his team was winning or more likely losing, right? But he was watching games habitually, and that drew him in even more. It reinforced this identity that he has as a Broncos fan. And of course, you know, there were other habits, right? Reading Broncos news, buying Broncos gear, or getting presents, right, from other people, Broncos stuff. If you walk into his office, you'll notice there's a sign in his office, you know, Broncos fan, parking only, right? I'm not sure who parks in his office. But anyways, that sign is there, and right above that is a Broncos clock. And on the other side of the room, up on the bookshelf, you see a couple Broncos mugs. You come over to his desk, and there is a coaster. Broncos again. It's really obvious as you walk around his office that Pastor Joel loves his family. He is into golf and he's into the Broncos. And if you pull open the mini fridge, you can see that Diet Pepsi plays an important part in his life as well. But as we think about this idea of identity, that's what we're talking about in this particular series. And I'm picking on Pastor Joel right at the moment. But Pastor Joel, is a family man. He really is. He's a husband and a father, and he owns that deeply, right? He's a golfer, recreationally, but he is interested in golf, and he likes being a golfer. He is a Broncos fan, and he is a Diet Pepsi drinker. And all of these identities that he has are habitually reinforced as he participates in actions which have now become automated. Daryl Dash talks a lot about habits and their role in our spiritual life, and he made this statement: for better or worse, we live according to habit. We think we live our lives according to design or thought when almost half of our lives operates on autopilot. Yeah, you heard that right. Scientists estimate that about 50% of what we do is pure habit. We don't think about it anymore, we just do it. Right? 50% of our life operates on autopilot. In part three of this series about identity, we talked about that link between habits and our identity and how our core identity gets lived out through our habits, but our core identity also gets reinforced through our habits, right? Who we are becomes more deeply entrenched, our identity. That's what we're talking about. It becomes more deeply entrenched. It gets reinforced through our habits. Like the more we do the thing habitually, the more we are who we are. Now that can be a very good thing. Man, as a fact, that's an awesome thing. Number one, it relieves a lot of mental energy, right? If we had to think about everything we do, if nothing was on autopilot, think of how difficult life would be. But second, this is a very, very good thing because it means if we can build the right habits, we can reinforce the right identities. We can be more and more a lion tamer, an image bearer, right? Not God, but God's friend and a body part. This is a very, very good thing that identities can be reinforced, strengthened through our habits. That's awesome. But it leads to a question, though. Can a non-core identity be reinforced by habits? We know that our core ID can be, but can a non-core identity also be reinforced by actions that we do habitually? Well, yes, right? Yes, we've seen it in our own lives. We've seen it in our family. We've seen it in our friendships and our colleagues, right? We see it all the time. Let me just, you know, throw out a few examples. If I just happen to be exposed to some information from a specific group, a specific tribe, whatever you want to call it, that doesn't really mean much. But if I spend time consuming that information, stuff about the Buffalo Bills, right, for example, doing that over and over, day after day, I go from being somebody who's just, you know, been a bit informed about that particular group or that tribe, to being a member, maybe not physically a member, but emotionally, I am a member. I'm part of the Bills Mafia or whatever. I'm a Broncos fan, whatever, right? As we spend time consuming information from a specific group, we become a member of that group, of that non-core identity. You got built, strengthened through habits. The same thing could be said about someone who, you know, evaluates how much they accomplish at the end of the day. That doesn't mean much if I do that once. But if I, other than perhaps I'm a productive person, but if I do that day after day, evaluate how much I accomplish, then eventually that's going to ratchet up a little, right? Eventually I'm going to be evaluating how I feel about the day based on how much I have accomplished. And I go from being a productive person to maybe a productivity addict. Or if I'm a person who's unmarried and I compare my happiness with the happiness of my married friends, if I do that habitually, I join the ranks of that group. I become one of the unfulfilled singles or something like that. If I ride my bike and I do that over and over again, and maybe I'm learning about cycling gear in my off time, right? I'm checking out some stuff on YouTube or something like that. Over time, those actions, which I do habitually, reinforce this identity that I'm a bicyclist, right? Or if I am a person who day after day ends the day with whatever to help unwind, that builds a new identity. That action builds a brand new identity. Eventually, I am part of my identity is I'm an addict. That's certainly not core to who I am. It's a non-core thing, but it becomes part of my identity. Or if I start the day once with a little jolt of caffeine through some, you know, cup of coffee, cup of Joe, that doesn't make me anything. It doesn't affect my identity. But if I am a person who starts my day with a jolt of caffeine to help me get energized and alert, and I do that day after day, that becomes part of my habit. Well, then I join the ranks of, what do you call it, American adults? I don't know. But an identity is built and it is reinforced and strengthened through habits. So habits can build and strengthen and reinforce our core identity. Habits can build and strengthen and reinforce a non-core identity. How about a completely wrong identity? Like something that's not core and something that we were never meant to be. Could that work the same way? Could that be reinforced and built through actions that are now habits? Absolutely. Many of us have deep pain in our hearts because someone that we know, someone that we love, has changed. It's like they become a whole different person, and they did it through some actions that have now become habits and has built for them a brand new identity, one that is not who they were ever meant to be, not who they ever probably even thought they would someday be. Maybe they're caught in a pattern of abuse or enabling behaviors, and now they are a different person, right? They are an abuse victim, or they are an abuser, or they are an enabler, a codependent person. Maybe they're someone who has an angry mob mentality, or they're a cult member, and they're caught, and they're in this group, but that's who they are. It's become part of their identity, but it's not who they were meant to be. And our heart breaks for them. How did they get there? Some actions that they repeated over and over that became habitual. And those habits built and then reinforced a completely wrong identity. It's no longer just an action. It's an identity, and it's getting worse because it's being habitually reinforced. Right? If your ID gets lived out and reinforced by habits, you'll want to learn about how to make and break habits. Now, before we go any further, let me just pause and say something important. Today, as we do this study together, this is going to be less Bible text explanation, right? I'm not going to be pulling up a lot of passages. We're going to look at a couple, but we won't be spending a lot of time going through a section of Scripture and talking about what does it mean? What does it say? What did it mean to the people when it was written? What does it mean to us? There's a lot less of that today and a lot more about biblical application. We're going to talk about how do we obey the Bible commands that we already know. So I'm going to present a list of 7 tips for habit formation. These are adapted from several sources, tinyhabits.com. That's an interesting place to check out. They have a free 5-day training on how to build habits. Also from How to Grow by Daryl Dash and Atomic Habits by James Clear. Tips for habit formation. Tip number 1, start small. Start small. Shrink the habit. Okay, until you're 90% sure you can do it. You want to do a 5K? Not sure you can do a 5K? Or maybe you're confident that you cannot do a 5K. Well, don't start with, well, I'm gonna race or I'm gonna run, 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers. Start really, really small. James Clear advises us to ask, what can I stick to, even on my worst days? He points out that a habit needs to be established before it can be improved, right? You need to start by mastering the art of showing up. We can improve the habit. We can build it later. In his 30 Days to Better Habits workbook, he reminds us, start by focusing on who we wish to become, not on what we want to achieve, right? We talked about that in part 3. Then you choose a habit that reinforces that identity. Then we go to the 2-minute rule. When you start a new habit, it should take less than 2 minutes to do it. You heard that right. When you start a new habit, it should take less than 2 minutes to do it. Obviously, you can't run a 5K in 2 minutes. What can you do? You can put on your shoes, step out the door, walk down the street for 30 seconds, 45 seconds, turn around, walk back home. Right? That's what you can do in 2 minutes. So that's it. Step 1 is to get in the habit of putting on your shoes, your running shoes. And friends, don't underestimate the power of this step. There's so much power just in showing up and just getting started. Then we move on to the implementation intention. This is your plan for how you intend to implement the habit. Determine when and where you'll do the action. So, for example, you want to do a 5K someday. You're going to get started by, you determine when, where, how it's going to start. Well, you're going to come home. Maybe you'd say, I'll come home. And then at 5:30, I put away my work clothes. I put on my running shoes, right? So that happens in my bedroom. And then I'm going to walk out the door at 5:30, and I'm going to do, right, that 2 minutes worth of walking or jogging or whatever, but 2 minutes. That's tip number 1. Start small. Tip number 2. Shape the environment. Shape your environment. Modify your environment so that it supports the habits that you want to create. And you can also shape it so that it makes it harder to indulge in the habits you want to break. So, for example, you want to do the 5K someday. Start by, let's shape it so it's harder to do the wrong thing. Hide the snacks that you'd normally maybe get into when you first get home from work. And instead, put a water bottle in a very prominent place and your running shoes there. Tip number 3, use triggers and rewards. Use a trigger that prompts the action, something that cues up, it's time to do this now. And then use things that lead to a reward. So the advice is make the cue or the trigger a big part of the environment. For me, one of the things I've done is I've decided I'm using the same shelf that I put my lunchbox on and my outdoor shoes. Same shelf, same place. So as I come home from work, I put my lunchbox away, but to do that, I pull out my outdoor shoes. And so the cue or the trigger, hey, it's time to go out and do it, is a natural part of the environment. I need to put my lunchbox away, and the shoes are right there, so I can then go up to my room, get changed into my outdoor stuff, and then out the door. The cue is obvious there. And then you want to reward showing up, right? So we got a trigger. We want to think about a reward. And obviously, it needs to be a reward that's actually helpful. So if my goal is a 5K, ice cream can't be the reward. The reward can be very, very simple. It could be as simple as I've got a calendar on the wall, and after I've just showed up and done the thing that I'm supposed to do, just go over, grab the marker, and put a big X on today. And I look at it, and I see this streak of X's across the calendar. That might be the reward. If that's rewarding to you, I mean, that's a great, simple one. For other people, it's like 10 minutes of something that they really wanted to do, but they put off doing that thing they really wanted to do until they did this thing that they really needed to do, right? But use a trigger and use rewards. Tip number 4, focus on making progress, right? Focus on making progress. Taking small actions consistently matters way more than taking big actions occasionally. Focus on making progress. Tip number 5, when you fail, stop right there. Notice I didn't say if you fail, right? The authors, the experts on habit formation are really wise to write it this way. When you fail, you're going to fail. I'm going to fail. There's going to be a failure day. When you fail, pick yourself up and get going again. It's okay to have a failed day. It's just not okay to have 2 in a row. If you have 2 failed days in a row, that's a new habit that you're building, right? When you fail, pick yourself up, get going again. Tip number 6, leverage what works for you. You know you, or if you don't know you, experiment and find out how you work best, what will work best for you. But try to figure out an answer to this question. Do you do best with habit formation when you have structure or variety or social support? Some of us, man, we thrive with structure, doing exactly the same thing day after day after day, just building on it as we go. Some of us, that works great for us. For others of us, that is so boring. It makes us never want to do it again. And so we need variety. So today is a run day. Tomorrow is a basketball day. The next day is a tennis day. I don't know, something like that. But variety works best for them. For some people, doing it on their own is awesome. It's like they get renewed while they're doing it. They have this time to themselves. You know, they say, this is me time. For other people, they need social support. They need accountability. They need somebody who's counting on them showing up at the same time. Or they need somebody who's going to see their Strava data and go, way to go, and cheer for them. What works best for you? Structure, variety, social support. And then leverage whatever that is that works best for you. And then number 7, pay attention to resistance. Resistance is when you're working and you're doing the right things, but it's not getting any easier to show up. I'm not saying the habit's easier, because you know, as we make progress, the habit might be harder. But it's getting harder and harder to stay motivated. If that happens, that's resistance. Go back and check to see what might be sabotaging your efforts. Did you start out too big? Are you not leveraging what works for you? If none of that seems to be the case, it might be a problem with your why. This often happens where people have an idea of like, what would be really great? Like, I think I'd be so much more productive if I get up at 5 in the morning. And they start doing it, but man, it's not working for them, and they start hating it and dreading it. The problem might be with why they're doing it. Maybe they don't really want what it is that they were trying to build the habit around. That might be it. It might be a problem with competing priorities, might be a problem with values, might be something else. But if resistance is there and going back and kind of shrinking the habit a little bit more and paying a little bit more attention to the environment doesn't fix that, then you want to look into that and figure out what's going on and why is that. All right, I want to move from that set of very practical tips for how we can build and make the habits that we want to make and go back to this issue of core identity. Specifically, I want to look at another place in the scriptures where we see the case being made for identity-based habits. In this case, the identity that we're looking to reinforce habitually is that of God's friend. I know in part 3, we talked about this from Romans 6. I showed that Paul was saying, you know, no longer do what you used to do because you're no longer who you used to be. You have a brand new identity and you need to live that out and reinforce that through some habits. But I want to show through the scriptures that that wasn't an isolated experience there. That wasn't the only time in the scriptures where we see identity-based habits. So I want to look at a couple more scriptures with you in the next couple minutes. In Colossians chapter 3, it's the Apostle Paul again, but he's writing to a different audience. And he's encouraging them to let their identity get practiced until they do it habitually. This is Colossians 3, verse 12 through 14. And Paul is saying, practice love. Right? Do love actions until you do it habitually. Practice love because that's who you are, a person who is dearly loved. Colossians 3, verse 12. Therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly loved, put on. Now that put on word, that's an idea. This is something in action that you're going to do, and you're going to do it over and over and over again, right? Until it becomes habitual. Put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a grievance against anyone, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you are also to forgive. Above all, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Paul gives us some very specific actions that we're going to practice. Compassion, kindness, gentleness, humility, patience, forgiveness, right? We're going to put these things on. We're going to practice them until it becomes habitual. Why? Because that's how we live out, and that's how we reinforce who we are. Who are we? Chosen, holy, dearly loved people. Peter teaches exactly the same thing. Live out your identity through actions that become habits. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and chapter 3, he says, you are different, and so I want you to live differently from unbelievers, right? This is who you are, a different person. How's that going to show up in the world, and how are you going to reinforce the fact that you're not just like everybody else? You're going to live differently. You're not going to live like everybody else. In chapter 2, verses 9 to 10, he starts by explaining who you are. He says, but you are a chosen race, a holy priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his possession, so that you may proclaim the praises of the one who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. He starts with, this is who you are. Right? This is your identity. You individually are part of something bigger. You are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are people that God has specifically chosen for himself. Right? You are God's people. This is who you are. You are not like everyone else. You are different. Now live differently. And then he gives them the set of actions that he wants them to do. And as they do these actions, this will reinforce the fact that they are not like everyone else. So in verse 11, first set of actions, abstain from sinful desires. Everybody else is giving in to their sinful desires, but you aren't everybody else. So you're going to abstain from sinful desires. You're going to do it today. You're going to do it tomorrow. You're going to do it the next day. And slowly but surely, you're going to build the habit of abstaining. And that will reinforce the fact that you are indeed who you already are. Right? Verse 12, he gives the next set of actions that are meant to become habits. Conduct yourselves honorably among unbelievers. Verse 13 is a third one. He says, you're going to be different than the rest of the world because you're going to submit to every authority, every human authority, right? Yeah, that's different, but you are different. You're going to live differently. And then he goes on to list what those human authorities are that we're going to submit to. Verses 13 to 17, it's the government. In verses 18 to 25, he addresses the issue of slave masters, or by extension, employers. And in chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, spouses that have authority. And then in chapter 3, verse 8, he gives another way that we're going to live differently. We're going to live in unity. We're going to love one another. And when people insult us, we're going to pronounce a blessing on them. At first, that's going to be really hard. We'll do the action. But as we do that action over and over and over again, it will become our habit. And we start with doing this. We start living, you know, the motive for living differently is because we are different. But over time, through these habits, we reinforce that we really are different. We really are a chosen people, loved by God, a royal priesthood meant to represent people to God, right? We could do exactly the same thing. We could make a similar case for identity-based habits, looking at our identity as a body part. As you think about that, you read through the scriptures and they'll say, you are a body part. Now, here are the actions you're going to want to practice so that they become habits. Let me make three more quick observations about our core identity. Number one, if we don't live out our core identity, we'll live out a different identity. And we'll do it without even thinking about it, right? It's just habit, right? If it's not your core identity that's being lived out, it'll be something that's not part of your core, perhaps even a completely wrong identity, somebody we were never meant to be. Observation number two, core identity helps us know which habits are worth pursuing. Well, for example, why should we fast? Or why should we give? Or why should we pray? Or why should we wash one another's feet? Because those things are consistent with our core identity. Observation number three, our core identity keeps us from making the habits into the goal, right? Our core identity says that we are God's friend. And so therefore the goal is to enjoy Jesus' love and to love him back. The goal is not to become a self-righteous person who has mastered all the right habits. No, that's not the goal at all. The goal is to live out the fact that we are God's friend in a very practical way or through very practical habits. The goal isn't to have the habits. The goal is to reinforce the identity. If we're talking about core identity, it's who we actually already are. It's to reinforce that and live that out. That's the goal. The habits are means, but a very, very necessary means, but never the goal in and of themselves. And so, dear friends, let's choose and keep habits that put us on the path of God's grace. We don't need all the habits. We don't need all the even useful habits. We need to choose and keep habits that put us on the path of God's grace. And we can use the tips that we talked about today to help make it happen. And if I'll do that, if you'll do that, you'll become who God says you truly are. And that will be great. That will be awesome. Praying for you. I hope this has been helpful. We'll wrap this series up in part 5. See you then. If we can help you or be praying for you, don't hesitate to reach out. You can call us or you can email us. That's at office@panamabaptist.org. May what you've experienced in this service help you to live out your faith in God when you're at home with your family, when you're at work or school with your colleagues, when you're hanging out with your friends, when you're volunteering in your community, or spending time with people who aren't Jesus followers. That's our prayer and our hope for you today. Hey, join us again soon. We'll see you then.